And welcome to Jazz for Curious Listeners, just one of the many presentations that come to you from the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. My name is Lauren Schoenberg. I'm senior scholar at the museum. And this is Jazz for Curious Listeners again, and it's our series, Who Was, sometimes we say Who Is, Duke Ellington. This is the second part, and we're going to be featuring some of the great instrumental stars of the early Ellington band who set the style for their instruments, even to the point that after they were gone from the band, Ellington hired people who could bring that personality always to the forefront. But before we get into that, I think we'll just start with something kind of light and fun and rare. It's Ellington on a quiz show in the 1950s. It's called What's My Line? And for you young folks out there, What's My Line was a show that had four celebrity panelists. And they would bring someone out, and they would tell the audience what this person did for a living. But then the four panelists had to ask questions and try and figure it out. Believe it or not, it was a tremendously popular show. At the end of the show, they would have a celebrity come out, the panelists would put on a mask so they couldn't see who it was, and the celebrity guest would change their voice so they couldn't recognize the voice. Sounds kind of silly, but it was a good show. And Ellington was a big enough star to be the celebrity panelist. So I thought, just to get an indication of what he looked like in the mid years of his career and what a big star he was, let's just watch this short segment to start this show.
And so, as usual, we've provided them with blindfolds. Are they all in place, panel?
They are.
Good. Will you come in, Mystery Challenger, and sign in, please? Panel, as you know, in the case of our mystery celebrity, we dispense with all the usual preliminaries, get right down to the general questioning, which we will begin with Miss Arlene Francis.
Are you associated with the entertainment business?
Pardon, I didn't hear you.
Are you associated with the entertainment business?
Oh, yes, I am considered in the entertainment industry.
Oh, you are? Would you consider yourself an actor?
I have been mistaken for an actor, yes.
Would you consider yourself a leading man?
A leading man?
Yes.
Well, it has so happened that there have been performances where the entire thing has revolved around me, yes.
It has? Uh-huh. Well, have you ever appeared in pictures?
I have appeared in pictures, yes. You're
right. Have you been on the stage?
I have had the pleasure of playing on the stage also.
Do you always talk that way? Because I don't think you could project to New Jersey.
Play to New York.
Keep after him, Arlene. I think it's Ollie the Dragon.
Are you considered a character actor?
Well, I want you to know this is an extreme compliment, because I've waited for years for someone to acknowledge
your character?
Say you were. She asked you if you were. I think I'd have to give you a no on that. That's one down and nine to go.
Is it my turn now?
Yes, it's your turn, Mr. Seth.
Have you ever done anything on the stage besides acting?
Oh, yes, Mr. Seth, I have.
Have you ever directed any plays?
I've never directed a play.
Two down and eight to go, Miss Kilgallen.
When you say that you've done something on the stage besides acting, do you mean that you may have done something in a show connected with music?
Something in a show connected with music? You're right, yes. Something connected with music.
Do you either sing or dance?
I didn't hear you.
Do you either sing or dance?
I neither sing nor dance.
That's three down and seven to Gullum.
Do you play a music instrument?
I didn't hear you, Mr. Allen.
I'm not doing so well with you either. I said, do you play a musical instrument professionally?
Well, yes, I play a musical instrument, too.
You sound like you've been playing it all day. Is it a wind instrument?
Is it a wing?
A wind instrument?
A wind instrument. Oh, no, Mr. Allen.
Four down, six to go, Miss Francis.
Now, look here.
You tell him.
Do you use your hands with this instrument?
Oh,
I mean,
yes.
Are your hands the primary means,
yes,
of locomotion between you and the instrument?
Oh, yes, Miss Francis.
Is the instrument too heavy to be carried around the house on your back?
Well, I'm afraid it is just a little...
Is it a
pie,
Annie?
A what?
A piano.
A piano?
Uh-huh.
Ah, yes, Miss Francis.
That's what I thought you said, and I know you're not Oscar Levant, are you?
Oh, no.
No. You're a different type fellow. I bet you played at Carnegie Hall, even.
I have had occasion to play at Carnegie Hall, Miss
And
Francis.
I'll bet that it isn't King, and it isn't Prince. And it isn't Earl, but it's Duke something.
Duke Ellington.
Duke Ellington.
know, I was just wondering whether Dorothy was going to guess.
I thought she'd guess.
Dorothy is a great lover of Duke's music and goes to the Bandbox here in New York where Duke has been playing. And I thought Dorothy might get it with that soft voice.
I'm embarrassed. He fooled me.
Well, Duke, you embarrassed him. I love you for it.
Oh, thank you very much. I didn't get very far, though.
Thank you. Real good. Thank you. Blindfolds into the blindfolds all in place panel.
Yes, John. Yes.
Good. Will you come in, Mystery Challenger, and sign in, please?
One of the things that made Ellington the great composer that he was the way he listened. You know, he'd bring up someone into the band, check them out. If he decided to keep them, he would listen to them play without pretty much saying anything and figure out what key they sounded better in, what part of their instrument, what challenged them, which challenges could they rise to, a special note that they played, just one note. And he would keep track of all of this, and he would start to insert it into his compositions. He did this with all the great musicians in his band for the rest of his career. The great Albert Murray and Ralph Ellison, Stanley Crouch, have all written about how Ellington was like Shakespeare in the sense that he wrote specifically for the people in the band. Most bands you play in, most arrangements that are written, well, they're written for the first trumpet, the second trumpet, the saxophone, the third trombone. It really doesn't make a difference who played those parts. But in the Ellington band, in the same way that Shakespeare wrote for the individual quirks, idiosyncrasies of his actors, Ellington did this with his musicians. And by leaps and bounds, the first of the all-time jazz greats that was in his band was Sidney Bechet, the legendary New Orleans clarinetist and saxophonist, soprano saxophonist. And Ellington had this to say about him in an article he wrote in 1965 called "The Most Essential Instrument." Of all the musicians, Bechet, to me, was the very epitome of jazz. He represented and executed everything that had to do with the beauty of it all, and everything he played in his whole life was completely original. He was a truly great man, and no one has ever been able to play like him. He had his own ideas, and nobody could execute the music from the same perspective, accomplish the same musical ends. And just a few years before Bechet joined Ellington's band, and again, he was only there for a moment, 1926, a long-time collaboration with the great trumpeter James Bubber Miley also started. And between the way that Bechet played the clarinet and saxophone and the way that Bubber Miley growled on his trumpet, that set the stage for the sound of the Ellington band from that moment on. Even though they didn't spend that many years in the band, long after they left, Ellington always had people who played in their general style. But let's start by hearing Bechet and then Bubber Miley.
Thank you.
What you're looking at here are record labels of some of the early great Ellington records from the mid to late 1920s, and you'll notice that the co-composer on all of them is Bubber Miley. And you know, it's funny, Billy Strayhorn deservedly gets so much credit for the great music that he collaborated on and that he wrote for his years with Ellington. But I think it's fair to say that if Billy Strayhorn had never joined the Ellington Band, Ellington's reputation would have been exactly the same. He composed in an Ellingtonian idiom. He had his own voice in that idiom. But with Bubber Miley, Miley collaborating in the 20s on Black and Tan Fantasy, on Creole Love Call, It Don't Mean a Thing If It Ain't Got That Swing, well, the title was taken from a Bubber Miley saying, and who knows about the melody, The Blues I Love to Sing. So many of the early Ellington classics were informed by Miley, and not just Miley's growl trumpet playing, but his melodies and his conception, along with Sidney Bechet, had a profound effect on the Ellington Band that lasted to the very last moment of the band's life. Now, we're going to listen to one of those early pieces that Miley had a big hand in. It's called Creole Love Call. And we'll hear an original recording from 1927 with Miley on the trumpet and some vocalizing there by Adelaide Hall. And then we're going to jump to a broadcast from Birdland in 1952. So you can just hear how the piece kept growing throughout Ellington's life. So, Creole Love Call, two times. Thank you.
going back now to those early days that started all this 25th anniversary celebration of Duke Ellington and the orchestra, back to 1928 and the Creole Love Call. This music doesn't send you, you just haven't been anywhere. That's all there is to it.
To get back to Sidney Bechet's legacy, you see him on the left here playing the clarinet. By the way, the drummer there is Big Sid Catlett, and on the right playing the soprano saxophone. And Ellington always had people in his band who brought back memories of those two sounds. And we're going to hear two of the original folks who brought that to the band. The clarinetist Barney Bagard was from New Orleans, originally featured, known best for his tenor saxophone playing, but evolved into a wonderful virtuoso clarinetist. And he took the Bechet legacy and mixed it with his own style, took some of another New Orleans clarinetist who was a disciple of Bechet's, the great Jimmy Noon, and came up with a style that, you know, would evoke Bechet at many times. Also, to evoke Bechet on the soprano saxophone and on the alto saxophone in later years, you know, for decades and decades, was the great Johnny Hodges. And Hodges, of course, known for his incredible romantic alto saxophone solos you know, in his smooth way of playing. But he also played the soprano, and in virtually everything he ever played, it's, to paraphrase Dan Morgenstern, it's pure Bechet and purest Johnny Hodges. So let's hear the Bechet legacy through clarinetist Barney Bagard and saxophonist saxophonist Johnny Hodges. And the Hodges piece is a rarity. It's him playing a tune associated with Bechet that the Ellington Band never recorded. It's called China Boy, and he plays the soprano sax, and there are moments where it sounds just like Bechet.
Our next number is a clarinet concerto written especially for and played by Barney Bagard, Clarinet Lament.
song from Arty Anderson, My
Old... The trombone section in the Ellington Band was one of its many outstanding features, and it was comprised of, from 1932 for about 14 years, of these three guys. The left, Lawrence Brown, in the middle, Juan Teasel, and on the right, Tricky Sam Nanton. And according to all folks who were there, what Ellington himself wrote, these were three idiosyncratic guys, very unlike personality-wise. And musically speaking, in their solo roles, totally distinct. And it would be hard to imagine how they could coalesce into a unified sound as three trombones, but they did. And not only did they coalesce into, you know, a unified sound, they really accomplished miracles. And they were known by the nickname of God's Trombones. And, well, we're going to delve into them specifically. Before we get into hearing them individually in their solo roles, how they were really known from listening, from people who would listen to the band, especially on records, you could tell right away who was playing. We're just going to listen to a snippet of a passage they played on a famous Ellington record from 1938. It's called Braggin' and Brass. And without getting too technical about it, they play a passage in which Ellington assigned the notes. There were three of them. So imagine that the notes are written on the music like this. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So each person has to get their note in there, the one, and then the two, and then the three. These are three different people. And the passage goes by just 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, like that. I'll tell you, for a band today, it's virtually impossible to pull this off perfectly. It's that difficult. And the fact that they managed this back in 1938 is just more testimony about how brilliant this section was. Just an excerpt here. What you're looking at here is an actual page of Duke Ellington's handwritten musical manuscript. This is for a piece written in 1937 called Diminuendo and Crescendo in Blue. And the reason we're looking at it just briefly is that we can see how Ellington wrote for the specific people in the band, how he would use their name as he wrote for them. And it helps us figure out what the trombones are doing, because by looking at some of these scores, you know, it's Ellington was such a master orchestrator. When you just listen to the music, it's hard to figure out who's doing what sometimes. He was such a magician in combining the trombones and the trumpets and the reeds and everything else. But it's by looking at articles like this, I should say documents like this, that we can figure out some of the magic and how he wrote these very complicated things for the trombones. Now let's go now to Juan Teasel. Teasel was not only a great trombonist in the band, he played the valve trombone, which is like a trombone, but with valves from a trumpet. It has a very different sound than the regular slide trombone. And he co-wrote with Ellington. Well, he wrote some great tunes on his own, and he collaborated with Ellington on many pieces. This is Caravan, which was one of his collaborations. And you'll see him. He has dark glasses, and he plays the valve trombone. And it, I don't know, some people think it sounds like a French horn in an orchestra. It's a very, very different, almost non-jazzy sound. But, of course, if it's in the Ellington Band, it's by definition jazz. But here we get to see and hear the great Teasel.
Thank you.
Lawrence Brown was an amazing musician. Maybe the right adjective for his time and his place would be fearless. In other words, he took the trombone to places with a virtuoso approach. He could play high, he could play low, he could play it in a way that would have fit, you know, almost in the symphony orchestra in terms of his brilliant virtuosity. And he was a dependable guy who could always just play the lead part or play the quote-unquote strong part. That's not a great word. But anyway, he was the solid rock on which the trombone section was founded. And we're going to hear an excerpt of him playing with the band, and you can just kind of hear this way that sounds very different from Juan Tiesel, who we just heard, and equally different from Tricky Sam Nanton, who will follow. Lawrence Brown.
And now, friends, this next one is captioned. A very, very nice tune, after all. Features Johnny Hodges on alto sax and Lawrence Brown on trombone.
Thank you.
This is Joe Nanton, known as Tricky Sam, because in the early Ellington band, along with Bubber Miley, who we talked about before, he pioneered a way of playing with the plunger mute and other kind of mutes that set the standard for the way that the Ellington trombone would sound. And here's a wonderful picture of him taken in the 1940s. And it was uncanny, the sounds he could make. He could laugh like a horse on the trombone. He could sound like a baby crying. He could sound like an otherworldly creature. I mean, these are just, you know, certain kind of words to paint a picture. But he could make the most wild and beautiful and unusual sounds. And I like to think of, you know, someone going to hear the band, maybe dancing on the dance floor, never having heard a trombone sound like this. And, you know, your back is turned to the band and all of a sudden you hear this sound. And you say, who's singing? What is that? You turn around and there's no one singing in front of the band. Just the band's playing. And if you weren't looking carefully, you wouldn't notice that one of the trombones had a plunger mute, just like you see in this picture, and was creating these weird, wonderful, beautiful sounds. And we'll listen to two things. The first, just an excerpt from a 1940 recording of Chloe, in which Tricky Sam Nanton plays the melody, and listen how he alternates his sound. It sounds like two different instruments. And then we'll see a film clip from 1943. The band actually pre-recorded it, and they had to kind of fake it when they were playing to the recording. But nonetheless, we get to see Tricky Sam Nanton stand up and play. And again, you know, just the third part of this incredible trombone trio.
No!
Don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing.
It don't mean a thing, all you gotta do is swing.
Makes no difference if it's sweet or hot. Just give that rhythm every little thing you've got.
It don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing.
Thank you.
equally idiosyncratic as Joe Tricky Sam Nanton was the cornetist Rex Stewart. And by the mid-1920s, most cornet players had switched to the larger and more popular, brighter-sounding trumpet. Rex Stewart stuck with the cornet and evolved a way of playing. He had many different ways of playing. One was very strongly influenced by Bix Beiderbecke, but his most original style was by what we call a half-valve technique. And very simply put, you know, when you see a trumpet player play, they're pressing down the three valves, and that's how they change the notes on the instrument. He would press a valve down halfway, a third of the way, a quarter of the way, all different percentages, and get these very unusual vocal-like sounds. And this became his stock and trade. And the band, in fact, had a very popular routine they used to do in theater appearances where the band singer, Ivy Anderson, would pick up a telephone on the stage and she'd say, "Hello, is this, you know?" And then Rex Stewart would have a conversation with her by pressing down these valves on the cornet. And people in the audience swore that they could understand exactly what he was saying. Speaking of swearing, he could also say words that were neither three or five letters. You can figure that one out. People would say exactly what he was saying. He was a brilliant musician, and his style was humorous and could be equally serious and somewhere in between most of the time. And we'll hear two samples. The first is a piece that later became known as Boy Meets Horn, which was his solo feature in the band. This is the original version done faster, and Ellington called it, probably onomatopoetically, twits and twerps, which would be maybe a way of getting into a sound, these funny sounds that Rex Stewart would make. And then we'll see a brief film clip of him from the 1957 The Sound of Jazz broadcast, where you can actually see his fingers on the cornet and see how he got some of these effects. Thank you. mentioned before about Bubber Miley and about how he set the growl trumpet style for the Ellington Band, we have to mention Cootie Williams. His real name was Charles Melvin Williams, and he came into the band just as Bubber Miley was leaving, late 1928, early 1929. And he was a trumpet player for all seasons. He was a wonderful lead trumpet player, and by that we mean somebody who played the top note of the band with strength and clarity and consistency. But he became most famous for playing in the Bubber Miley mode of growl trumpet. And he evolved his own style, and he became one of the greatest stars in the Ellington Band. And we will listen to his classic 1940 Concerto for Cootie, which really features him on the open horn and also with his characteristic growl trumpet, one of the giants in the whole Ellington history. One of the most major influences, not only in the Ellington Band, but in jazz, showed up in the Ellington Band in 1940. His name was Ben Webster. He played the tenor sax. He was always pining to be a member of the Ellington Band. He actually subbed in the band for Barney Bagard in the 1930s, but he finally joined. Ellington didn't have a place for him before that. Ellington had four saxes, and he wasn't about to get rid of any of them. In 1940, Ellington decided to, like many other bands, add a fifth saxophone. And he put out the call to Ben Webster. And Webster came in and not only established the sound of the Ellingtonian tenor sax, but also a new approach to the tenor sax. It wasn't Lester Young. It wasn't Coleman Hawkins. It wasn't anybody. It was a lush, breathy way of playing, especially on ballads. And it influenced people on every instrument, from Charlie Parker to Jim Hall to Art Farm, just name it, to Miles Davis. I mean, everyone learned so much from the great Ben Webster. We will listen to Ben and see Ben playing a tune that he originally recorded with Ellington, but this is done later. It's called Chelsea Bridge. It was written by Billy Strayhorn. And unfortunately, the announcer announces the personnel of the band kind of over the music, so I won't give you their names, but this is Ben and one of the major foundations of the Ellington sound.
Webster now, and Chelsea Bridge by Billy Strayhorn. Hank Jones, piano. Ben Webster, tenor saxophone. George Duvivier, bass. Joe Jones, drums. Buck Clayton, trumpet. And Vic Dickinson, trombone. Thank you.
Finally, we come to the bass. And the bass was always a very important instrument from Ellington from the 1927 on. Whenever he made a record, he spent a lot of time at a recording studio making sure that the bass was near a microphone, that it was being recorded in a certain kind of way, when most bands were not paying anywhere near that attention to the rhythm section or specifically the bass. Of course, in later years, this became, you know, one of the main sounds of jazz to most folks, is the walking bass or the bass line. Ellington had some wonderful bassists. Wellman Brough really kind of set the standard, and then Billy Taylor, the bassist, and also Hayes Alvis. And eventually, in 1939, a young kid from St. Louis showed up. He was found in St. Louis, let's put it that way, the great Jimmy Blanton. And although Blanton was only in the band through 1941, he died tragically of tuberculosis in 1942. During that period, he made records that changed the role of the bass in jazz unlike anything else that had happened. Not to say there weren't fine players before him, but Blanton set the standard that is still being followed in most jazz to this very day. Absolutely brilliant playing. And Ellington featured him on a rare duet record. I mean, nobody was making records of piano and bass with the bass playing the melody and playing all kinds of fancy stuff in those days. However, Blanton did it with Ellington. And this is called Pitter Patter Panther. And here's Jimmy Blanton as we conclude our trip through the great Ellington stylists of the 20s, 30s, and 40s. Thank you so much for joining us for Jazz for Curious Listeners, Who Was Duke Ellington Part 2. My name is Lauren Schoenberg. I'm the senior scholar at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. We have a lot of programs, and they're all not historical in nature. Many things, contemporary artists, contemporary issues, things that relate to jazz or intersect with jazz. To find out about them, just go to our website at www.jmih.org. You see the address there in the lower left-hand corner of the screen. Our Facebook page, our YouTube channel, where many of the programs eventually wind up, so you can watch them at any time. And, well, again, on behalf of our board, our staff, our volunteers, everyone in our world, we welcome you to it and hope that you'll join us again soon for more of programming from the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. Stay safe, everyone, please.
Thank you.